When you close your eyes and focus on the breath as you feel it, you're moving from the level of sensuality to the level of form. It's a step up. The pleasures that can come from the level of form are much more refined and much less likely to lead to unskillful behavior than the pleasures of sensuality. So try to familiarize yourself with this level. The word for form, rupa in Pali, has many different meanings, but this is one of them, the body as you feel it from within. And it's composed of four properties or elements. There's the flow of energy, that's the breath, or wind. There's the warmth, that's the fire element. There's the coolness, that's the water element. And there's a sense of solidity, that's the earth element. And we focus on the breath first because it's the one that's most responsive. You can say short breathing and the breath will get shorter, or you can say longer and it'll get longer, deeper, more shallow, heavier, lighter. You can play with it. And it's also your first experience of the body. This is something we tend to miss. We think of the body as being basically solid. So that's our perception. But one of the important things you're going to learn as you familiarize yourself with these various properties or elements is the role that perception plays in emphasizing one or another. The body's not just plain sensation. There's going to be a perception behind the sensation. So here we're emphasizing the perception of breath, holding in mind the image that the breath can be an energy. It's not the air coming in and out of the lungs. It's an energy in the body itself. And there's a feeling of flow that comes in and goes out, but there's also the movement of energy inside the body itself that emanates from the body, one spot in the body or maybe several spots in the body as you breathe in. And that can spread throughout the body. It starts in the body, but it can go everywhere throughout the body if you let it. And your perception is going to help. So if you have trouble feeling the breath in any part of the body, just tell yourself it's there. Whatever you've got is the breath. And see if you can see it from that angle. As for the other elements or properties, you'll be experiencing them to some extent as you're focusing on the breath. There'll be parts that feel very solid, others that feel warm, others that feel cool. When a John Fung was teaching meditation, he'd say you could play with those a little bit, but you really get serious about them when the breath has been taken care of. In other words, you filled the body with breath energy. All the breath channels in the body are well connected, and the energy level is full, so that you feel less and less and less need to breathe in, breathe out. The energy feels balanced, and it suffuses everywhere. And it's so well connected that if there's a sense of lack of breath energy in one part of the body, an excess from another part will come right in. That's when a John Fung would have you think about the fire element. It's the same sort of principle. When we're working with the breath, you start with one spot in the body, make that comfortable, and then let that comfortable breath spread. With fire, you find whatever spot in the body seems warmest. You focus your attention there. Hold in mind the perception of warmth at the same time. Then you may find that you're turning up the heat a little bit, which on a cool night like this is pleasant. And then think of it spreading. You can do the same with water. It's a sensation of coolness in the body. Then there's solidity, earth. You can think of the bones. Think of the whole body being solid. Then it would have you think of bringing these different elements into balance. not too heavy, not too light, kind of like Goldilocks porridge. Not too warm, not too cold. And then try to maintain that sense of balance. It's from there that he would then have you go into the formless states. But before you go to formlessness, you've got to get yourself really familiar with form. So we work with these elements, one, to give a sense of well-being, but also, two, to familiarize ourselves with the body as we feel it from within, and to see the connection it has with what is called name in Pali, nama. In some cases, it's just the other four aggregates, feeling, perception, mental fabrication, and consciousness. In some cases, that mental fabrication gets divided up into attention and intention and mental contact. This gets us into dependent co-arising. All this is dependent on consciousness, consciousness is dependent on this, and the two of them are dependent on fabrication. And insight lies in seeing that. The extent to which your experience of the body as you feel from within is shaped by your intentions, the way you pay attention to things, your perceptions. It's not simply a given. And you want to be able to dig that out, because all too often the perceptions are subconscious. There was a period when I was meditating. I was away from a jhana fuyang for a couple months. And toward the end of the period, I was getting so that I found it harder and harder to breathe. It just seemed like everything in the body was way too solid, way too unresponsive. And the more I tried to breathe, the less the body seemed to want to breathe. I finally had a chance to visit a jhana fuyang. He said, "Well, you're focusing on earth." It hadn't occurred to me at all. Then he said, "Well, focus on space instead." And that cleared up the problem right then. And the lesson I learned, of course, is the power of perception, the power of these subconscious perceptions, which is why it's good to bring them out into the open. There's some meditation methods that tell you that the way you experience the body from within directly is just pure sensation, raw data. And that hides the fact that it's actually been processed. It's like listening to a news story and thinking what you're getting are bare facts, when actually they've been chosen and massaged. So you don't know the real story. And if you're told this is raw sensation, then you're not going to look back and say, well, what shapes the raw sensation? But when you're alert to the fact that it's already shaped by your perceptions, you start looking for them. And one way to look for them is to challenge them. Try other perceptions. And see the mind's tendency to want to go back to the old ones. And the effect that it will have on how you experience the body, how you experience the breath, how you experience the other elements. This relates to the Buddha's choice of the word element, or dhatu, property. Because in the physics of that time, these properties, or elements, were latent. And then when they became stronger, it's because they had been provoked. For example, on the external level, if you took a fire starter, you were said to be provoking the fire property, and a fire would appear out of the potential that was there. In the same way, the properties inside the body, they get provoked by your perceptions, by what you pay attention to. And the two of them feed each other. When you think of warmth, You look around to see, well, where are the sensations that are warm? You pay attention to those, and then the attention and the perception will magnify each other. And you've learned an important lesson, a lesson in cause and effect, a lesson in karma. Those are the two principles that you always have to keep in mind when you're listening to any of the Buddhist teachings. When you're reading about mindfulness, how does mindfulness relate to karma? How does it relate to causality? When you read about goodwill, how does it relate to karma and causality? It's only when you see these things in that light that you'll understand the uses of these teachings. Well, it's the same with name and form. The name is the active side. Form is the more passive side. And you want to see how your mental activities, your perceptions, your acts of attention, your acts of intention, shape the way you experience the body. Because it is possible to have name without form, but it's not possible to have experience of form without name. There are formless beings. And there is form, say the form of dead people, but there's no experience of that form from within. The naming activities have gone. And so we're here focusing on the breath because we're going to learn about the mind. We're focusing on form because we're going to learn about the activities of name. Because it's the mental side that's causing the suffering. But it's also in the mental side where the solution to the problem of suffering is going to be found. And your experience of the body is a good place to learn a lot of these principles. So try to sensitize yourself to the way the breath feels and to what you can do with your different conceptions of the breath to give rise to a sense of well-being. Because this is the purpose of concentration practice, is to give you a sense of well-being, at the same time sensitizing you to what you're doing in the present moment. So you can be mindful and alert. And see where craving and clinging are coming into the whole process and how you can let them go. This is what the Buddha said, that those who practice mindfulness immersed in the body will see the deathless. Because as they look into the body, their experience of the body, they begin to see more and more of the mind in the present moment, in action. And through taking apart the activities of the mind, that's when you open up to something that's beyond name, beyond form. So pay a lot of attention right here.